Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So glad to see everybody tonight. Welcome to Increase International Ministries Empowerment Wednesday. Amen. Hallelujah. Are we excited about the things of God and the light of God, the illumination of God, fighting for us? Hallelujah. Pushing back those things that try to overtake us, but it doesn't work in Jesus' name. Amen. Because God is fighting for us. Amen. We are winners. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, praise with us. Hallelujah.
How great.
How great is our God?
It's our God.
Yes. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Right where you are. Hallelujah. Whatever's going on, tell the situation. God,
let's go.
Is great.
Let's go, say yo.
Great is thy God. Sing with me how great is thy God.
Tell somebody beside you, say,
all
on, praise him, hallelujah, bless his name, hallelujah. He's worthy, hallelujah. Glory to God.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. I like it when you just praise God because of his goodness, because you know who he is, and he's been faithful to you. Amen. You know, I don't believe that we're supposed to come to church and not have an experience. So I truly believe that God, and the faith he has given us to have an experience on every promise that he has promised us. So let us pray. Fathers, in Jesus' name we come tonight. We want to say thank you. We bless you. We honor your presence. We honor your goodness and the opportunity that thou has given us. So therefore, I acknowledge you in the midst of this great congregation all around this world, that this is your ability, it's not mine. And this anointing, it shall be used to destroy yokes and remove burdens, but the glory shall be given to you untouched, and that is in Jesus' name. For the Spirit of God does rest upon me, for you have anointed me, preach this gospel to the poor. You sent me here to broken hearted, preach it to the captives, cover sight to the blind, and set it free to those who are bruised in heart, and to preach the accept ye of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where the favor of God flows profusely. We want to say thank you tonight. And for Lord, I thank you that in my mouth you place the words of prosperity, freedom, and increase for the people who are present here today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So if you have your Bibles, come on, lift them up high, repeat after me and say, this is my Bible. Say, it is my word of God, and it's the living word of God, and it brings life to me. See, I can do what it says I can do, and I can be who it says I can be, and I can have what it says I can have. And say, my life is better after I've heard, spoken, and practiced this word of God. Now say, devil, you are too late because we are believers. Amen. We're going to continue tonight to talk about the supernatural power of salvation. And we're going to go into some greater depths into it, or expound a little bit more and receive more wisdom, understanding of it, and practical things. That's the main thing. It's the practical thing. The practical part is the most important element or thing to do after you hear the word of God. You know, a lot of people have cookbooks and things to that degree, and some people just don't use them. They don't become practical with it. And they can fix anything that's in that cookbook if they would just do what's in the cookbook. And it's important that we understand that this book can whip up anything you need if you practice the details, or I'll say the faith recipes of it. So I want to go over here and start in the book of Philippians. Now let's start at the book of Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. The book of Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. Amen. We're going to start there. I have a lot of things in my spirit that I want to preach. I don't want to do a smorgasbord and preach this and preach that and so forth. And, you know, stay on task here. You know, and a lot of us, we know that a great man of God has gone on to the kingdom of heaven. Dr. Jerry Savelle, he is on the preaching team with Kenneth Copeland. And it's amazing. And we was listening to his last message that he preached this month. And so I was just watching, and it's amazing how he talked about the things all the way back to Oral Roberts and Kenneth Hagin and so forth and so forth. And I like to hear those last messages because they leave clues there. It's an eye-opener. I show you some things. It's a refresher as well to help us to refocus on what we're supposed to be doing, how we're supposed to be doing, the faith that it needs, and the personal things that we have to do. Because sometimes you can be doing church so much that, you know, church is so much, it become church, and we just like, okay, it's part of the schedule, it's part of the routine of the week, and we miss out on the essence of it, we miss out on the purpose and the assignment of it. Because you really understand how, you understand the depths of it, you won't miss a service, you understand that, okay, this is my life, God is doing something, I won't be a part of what God is doing. And I mean, we miss service sometimes. Those things happen. You know, that don't make you bad. I don't put that out there. But we have a greater hunger and a thirst and a different perspective when it comes to hearing the word of God. You know what I'm talking about. Some people, they just want, you know, sing my song, preach my script, and, you know, let's go ahead and make the day happen. But let's go over here to the book of Romans 10 and 9. So I'm positioning my faith to hear what God is doing what attention he's trying to give us to focus on, how he wants our attention. And that mantle, that anointing that he has, it's resting in the world, not just on the church, but it's resting in his world. And we want to tap into that and take it to the next degree. I believe that the batons of our mentors and fathers are greater than one hand who's next. I believe it's enough for everybody. Amen. And so we're going to be tapping into that grace. So the book of Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it said, if thou shalt confess. Well, let's go to verse 8, please. I apologize. Let's go. He said, but what said that the word is nigh thee? He says, even in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. Now, he's talking about what's in your heart, and in your mouth is the word of faith that we preach. And so that means that when we preach the word of faith, the recipient job is to have it in their mouth. Amen. They need to have it in their mouth and in their heart. Because the way to get it is in your heart is through your mouth and your ears. Now let's look at verse 9. Verse 9 says this. He said, if thou shalt confess with the Lord, with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thy heart. Same thing again. Talk about these two elements, two components, part of your body. He's talking about the mouth and the heart, that on the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. He said, if you believe that, you shall be saved. Then he breaks it down to you in verse 10. He says this. He said, for with the heart you believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So with the heart, it believes unto righteousness, and then with the mouth, is confession is made unto salvation. So you see these two, salvation and righteousness. But that righteousness doesn't come in until salvation is made. That salvation is not made until one believes in the heart and confesses with his mouth. So what salvation does, salvation connects you to righteousness. Would you have all right to, basically, it's a two-part righteousness there, because the righteousness that God has is a part of righteousness that we receive from God. Amen. So we believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We call this the prayer of salvation. And so every prayer that we pray is a prayer unto salvation. And if we understand that, if that worked on that day, I'm talking like a putty cat to spin on. And if that worked on that day, amen, and you have the evidence of it right now, it'll work every time you pray. Because it worked on the biggest miracle you could ever perform in your life. That'd be translated out of the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light to his dear son. And so it worked on that day. So every time you pray, you have to believe in your unto righteousness, and with the confession is made unto salvation. You have to believe that. That's the prayer of salvation, and every prayer that we pray is a prayer of salvation. Sometimes we could pray so much to the point forget God, but I'm just going to pray, but not remembering how the whole system works, because you're just so used to praying. Instead of saying, I'm communicating with God to get something from God and what he wants me to do and what he wants me to have. And so it's important that we realize and keep this before our eyes so that we can stay connected to salvation, which is unto righteousness, and to the one who has saved us. Amen. Because when the day we got saved, we cry unto God. And now people, we just pray as, okay, this is something that I do. And some people don't expect anything when they pray. Because if you pray, I would say proficiently, but I would say if you pray with this understanding in this practical way, then there are benefits that the mind will never forget. There are benefits that the mind never forget. And so we have to keep our hearts connected to this strategy here. We have to keep it connected to that. So what salvation does, it usher us into righteousness, which is the supernatural power, is the authority behind your faith. It gives you rights to every spiritual and tangible blessing of God through and by Jesus Christ and the covenant that God made with Abraham. Amen. And so it gives us this access to this great power in spite of who you are, what's going on in your life at the present time. But the things that we have to do now, when you got saved, remember your condition that you was in when you got saved. Well, you know, did you have millions of dollars in the bank and everything was going good and everything, wow, I mean, the birds are singing everywhere you go and everything just, you know, wonderful? Mm-mm-mm. It wasn't like that. most people's in their worst state. They say, I have to surrender. I have to give up. You know, I'm not going to hell. You know, I have many signs. God has a plan for my life. God's been too good to me. I received this. I need God. Amen. And so that's the state that we were in when we received salvation. Amen. That was the state that we were in. And God got us out of that condition. And he said, listen, I can get you out of anything. I can save you out of anything unto righteousness as we continue to believe in our heart and make that confession with our mouth. So every time there's an issue or not an issue, you have to continue to believe in your heart and make that confession unto salvation. You have to always do that. And not only that, but get excited about it. You know, there's things that I talk to God about. He said, won't you just go ahead and fix it? He said, I'll show you right here. He said, do A and B and I'll do C. He said, you go ahead and fix it. Because there's things that you couldn't hope to be saved. You know, you had to be practical to be saved. You had to do some things to get saved. You know, you say, oh, I just hope to get saved one day. No, you did it on your own through Christ. It was there available for you. It's like water. I go and I receive it. He made it available for me. And so everything else is just like that. Everything else from that time of where eternity was, we was adopted into eternity from that day forward. Everything is exactly like that. And so God said, listen, use your salvation. He said, use it. He said, there's a situation going on right here. He said, go ahead, use your salvation. He said, see how it works. Work it and work the supernatural power that it holds in for you. Now, let's go over here to Philippians, and we're going to look at, because I'm going too fast here. Look at Philippians, and we're going to focus here on chapter 2, I believe. Chapter 1. So when I understand salvation, righteousness, it ushers me into protection, soundness, wholeness, and peace and confidence in every area of my life because I know how it works. If it saved me from going to a burning hell and brought me into the throne of grace, that's what I had to keep my mind each and every time I pray or any time I deal with a situation like. So in the book of Philippians chapter 1, he says this. In verse 18, he said, what then, notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I then do rejoice, and yea, I will rejoice, for I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Then you talk about according to my earnest expectation and my hope. Now, but the part I want to look at, Paul says about that, he said, I'm going to rejoice about this. You follow me? And so, you know, have you what'd be a good illustration, Holy Spirit? Let's say there was an urgent situation and it was overwhelming, like say something financially, okay? And then you just remember that you had X amount of dollars tucked underneath your mattress. It was there before the problem came. And so you begin to rejoice over that. And so what it is that salvation is that deliverance has been tucked away for you. And when you rejoice about it, amen, you'll always understand there's nothing in life that can overtake you because you have deliverance, you have salvation. But we have to be mindful to rejoice over. So I'm not going to go in prayer and beg God. I'm not going to go in prayer and cry about the situation. I'm not going to go in prayer and doubt in my heart. I'm going to go in prayer and rejoice. Lord, thank you for salvation, Lord. And so, Lord, show me how to use salvation here. Show me, Lord God, what to say in this matter here. Lord, I thank you. I rejoice in my salvation, Lord God. I joy in it, Lord. Lord, I'm happy that no matter what comes my way, Lord God, I'm delivered. I'm safe no matter what. Have you noticed that we don't sorrow like the world sorrow? We don't grieve like the world grieve? And the world can go through trials and tribulations and hardship, and they just lose their mind over them. When something happened to us, they won't know unless we tell them. Or they, you know, we give them our testimony. They can't believe, you know, the peace that passes all understanding because we have something on the inside of us called salvation. We're saved from all that grief. Amen. We're saved from it. And it's important for us to thank God for that power. Amen. You're not pulling your hair out your head because of something happened. You know, you thank God for that power. You thank God that all your children are saved. You thank God that your children are going to serve the Lord. You thank God that whatever's going on in your life is going to turn to your salvation. Amen. It has to turn. Why? Because God said it in his word. Then somebody said, well, how are you going to trust the Bible because a man wrote the Bible? Then one guy said, well, who else going to write it? A monkey? A giraffe? He said, a man wrote the cookbook. He said, you still making recipes? What's wrong with that? Somebody had to pen it. And because the way it is, just thank you, Holy Spirit, and the perfection of it, man couldn't write that in his own ability. So that showed that God inspired him. Man cannot come over a story like this and keep the correlation and keep it intact. Man can't do that. Look how many years that's in here, and everything still lines up. No editing. You follow what I'm saying? Man cannot do that. So that shows that God inspired man to write this Bible. Amen. People who say such things are those who just looking for excuse not to obey what's in it or not to accept what's in it. Amen. But God inspired man to write this Bible. And because the way it is written, we know that God was in it. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. And that is so powerful. So we have this supply in the Spirit. Somebody say supply in the Spirit. And this supply in the Spirit is given to the one who is saved. So every time you need healing, you need restoration, peace, or answer, wisdom, all those things is all in the salvation package. And it's already in the supply of the Spirit. It's there for the saved. And you have to know how to get there. When I say get there, you have to know how to use what is there through prayer. Know that it's there. Okay? When you know something is there, you begin to make a request for it based on righteousness. Based on righteousness. I have the right to live this way, I have the right to drive this way, I have the right to eat this way, I have the right to give this way, I have the right to think this way, I have the right to be on these levels of life. I have the right for that. God didn't save us so we could be old and ugly and just be in church and, you know, sitting up in church at time to go. No, he saved us to be prosperous people. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm loving that so much. I'm really loving that. Amen. And so when we look at this, we begin to see that my life is more powerful than what religion has claimed it to be. You know, most people say, are you saved? Are you sanctified? Are you filled with the Holy Ghost? I say, do you know exactly what you're saying? Are you trying to say, am I religiously saved? Or are you trying to say, I'm religiously sanctified? I'm religious? No, I'm not in those boxes that you put people in. We're in a place where there's no lid on it. Amen. Because those who speak that way, they only experience life on a level that no one else really wants it. Amen. That's why it's hard for them to win somebody. I was a friend of mine. We went to the same school. And then one day I saw him. He said, hello, brethren. How thou? Bless God. I said, come on, man. You from John Marshall. Nobody from John Marshall talk like that. Cut that out. You know you don't talk like that. Or maybe you smoke too much reefer now you talking like that. Are you hiding now? Because listen, you don't talk like that. So don't try to impress me because you went to school or Bible college. Don't try to do that. Because they teach you how to talk like that. And so we think that if we have this persona, we come across this way. Okay, these are my saved, we call it my saved uniform. You know, this is what saved people, how we sound, this is how we look, and this is what we do. But see, you got to be the one who's in the crowd, but not of the crowd, and sticks out in the crowd. Amen. That's the type of person Jesus wants you to be. Amen. He wants you to be that person that's in the crowd, but not of the crowd, but you stick out of the crowd. You don't have to come in there and, you know, singing a praise song. You don't have to, you keep that melody in your heart. There's nothing wrong with that. But you don't have to do all these dramatic things, theatrical things to secure your salvation. You are saved when you go over the speed limit. You are saved when you run the yellow light. You saved when you pay your taxes late. You saved when you file your tax. You still saved. Amen. So it's not all this other religiosity stuff that people put out there. Look, you're saved, you're saved. And you got to walk in the power of that. Because when you're saved, you got mercy, you got grace, you got favor, you got wisdom, you got open doors, you got all these things. You can stop, you can prevent things, et cetera, et cetera. And you got so much power and so forth. It's amazing because You know, I was kind of like joking the other night. I saw the storm way over the other side, like Henrico. I said, come over here. I said, I want a little bit of noise. Come over here. And the lightning said, pow, pow. I said, oh, see that? Look at that. And then it started coming. And you know, I scared everybody. Everybody got mad at me because I called the storm to come over here. I mean, they really got, it's all your fault. I said, well, I just a little wind. And, you know, I like the storm. I like it, you know. Sometimes it does get boisterous and everything. But we have, being saved, we have power and authority even over elements. Amen. It was salvation that pulled Peter out of the sinking water. And also it was salvation that gave him authority to walk on the water. Because you can't separate the Savior from salvation either way you look at it. Amen. So it's vital for us to tap into, as every believer's responsibility, to tap into the wisdom and the power that salvation holds for us. Amen. So let's look at Philippians 1 and verse 27. Philippians 1, 27. Because I really want to get into super, super, supernatural things. I mean, grand things. I mean, I like to call it grand something. It just would be so grand, it'd be just so large. Amen. That no one can deny the faith that we have in Jesus Christ. And it'll be so attractive, people just want it. Amen. So he says in verse 27, he said, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit. Somebody say one spirit. He said, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. So you have to be in one spirit. You have that one mind when you're striving for the faith, together for the faith of the gospel. Let's look at verse 28. And in verse 28 says this. It said, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, plural, many, which is to them an evident token of prediction, but to you of salvation and that of God. He said, when you understand this, we strive together of one spirit, one mind, together for the faith. He said, and things are going to come up against you. Things are going to happen. He said, but don't be intimidated. Never be terrified. Don't be, the word terrified, that means to be intimidated by your adversary, which is to them an evident token of prediction. See, you got to understand this. When the enemy comes up against you, his whole purpose is to get your faith and trust out of your mind, out of your mind, out of your heart. That's his job, okay? That is his job, is to make sure that he shake you up so bad that you ain't trusting and you ain't believing, you just fearing of God. That's his job. But what salvation's job is to keep God, faith, and God's promises in your heart and in your mind. And once you have that, you understand there's nothing that the devil can do to you. And once he see you standing in save mode, I like to put it that way, in save mode, it's a prediction that everything he tried to do against you is have a doom date on it. Okay? It has a doom date on it. And I love that because, you know, when the devil see that you are saved and you know that you are saved, watch this now, he understands that he can't touch you. He cannot touch you because you know that you're saved. Mm-hmm. And because you're saved, you know your rights. And not only just your rights, you know the power that you have. And you're the last one that he want to mess with because he can see that you know that you are saved and you will embarrass him. So it's an evident token of prediction. It's an evident token of prediction to your adversary, but to you is the salvation that is of God. He said, don't be terrified by anything. He said, if you're not terrified about it, intimidated by it, you stand in a position, I like to call it, save mode. You follow me? So you know how most people, the first thing, when something unexpected happens, the first thing people do, they go into panic mode. First thing we go into. Or negative mode. Mm-hmm. Somebody's calling you, something negative, because they text you, something negative, or they didn't reply back to you, something negative, or, you know, somebody look at you or say they want to talk to you, something negative. It's always the first thought is going to be negative, or it's going to be to something that is, you know, and say that you don't think it's beneficial to you. It's always in panic mode. And one thing the Lord showed me, he said, you have to learn how to overpower panic. And the way you overpower panic is being in save mode. Amen. You be in save mode. You have to stay in save mode. Jesus said, I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Your Savior is still there. Your Savior is still there. Your salvation is still there. Because if you get into panic mode, you override, but you ignore, you forget about, let's put it this way, you neglect your great salvation. Okay, you won't use it. Then you try to be the Superman. Then you try to be the Savior yourself. And then you find out that you need to be saved in another area where you messed up again. And so it's important for us to realize whatever happened in your life, don't panic. Okay. It was a man in the Bible named Jairus. And Jesus asked for him to come and heal his daughter. And Jesus said, I'll come. And as they were going, then the woman with the issue of blood, she came in and put to halt the things that Jairus had requested. Then in between the time or windows of time, then the rulers or the people from the house of Jairus' house came and said, hey, don't trouble the Lord anymore. Your daughter is over with. And then Jesus said this. Immediately, Jesus spoke to him. He said, believe only. In other words, he said, don't give an ear to your situation and one ear to me. He said, give me both of your ears. Because, see, you can panic in one side of your head and struggling to believe on the other side of your head. You're trying to get it over to the other side. He said, believe on. That means let me have both of your ears. You got to block out all the stuff that's going on because all the stuff on the outside is trying to move you to panic. You follow me? He said, but if you keep focus on what I said that I would do. And it's amazing. God, if God said he's going to do something, don't matter what the devil does after, God's still going to do it. And we think because the devil did something that, okay, God didn't do it or he changed his mind or something. No, God's word is final. You follow? It is final. So the devil can do all this, but God still can do. Amen. So that takes your faith to a whole new level in God. Devil, you can try to kick up dust all you want, but God already said he's going to do it. Then God already said it's already been performed. So watch how we penetrate through all your foolishness and all your attacks. We'll penetrate all right through and through. It's not over because God said he would do it. God said it is done. God said he promised. And God cannot break a promise. He is the promise. He can't break a promise. Amen. And so no matter how things look in life, you got to believe God without panic. And always make sure you got to practice this. Say my first thoughts will always be positive. And you got to train yourself to think positive first. Amen. And a lot of people do that when I say, hey, can I see you have to serve that? Oh, Lord. I say, let your first thought be positive. But don't let it be too positive. You know what I'm saying? To the point you say, oh, he'll give a check for $1 million. Yeah, okay. But let's move on here. The devil, he attacks the mind, and then he wants to get what's in your mind to come out of your mouth. You follow me? He's not just there just to mess with you only. He wants to get something in an arena that he can spread it like a virus and bring it to manifestation. He said, if I get it in your mind and press on it, I can get it to come out of your mouth. If I get it to come out of your mouth, that's the legal system, watch it now, for defeat or victory. That's the legal system. Because the Bible says this. He said, by your own mouth are you justified. By your own mouth and words are you, what, condemned. So he knows that, and a lot of people don't pay attention to that. They just talk any way they want to talk, say anything they want to say, you know, and how they feel. And a lot of times when you talk about feelings, you're not talking intelligently. You know, you just talk about what's the next thing and how you feel about something. So it's really not even a conversation in that area. So it's important for us to realize, devil, you will not have my mind I know you want my mind because you want my mouth because I know I walk in authority. With these two together, I can make things happen. I can make these things happen, but I got to keep my mind stayed on Jesus. Amen. My mouth continue to speak his word because that's how we got saved. Amen. You can still be saved and take your life backwards. Some people, you know, if their life and their finance, their resources, their joy, and their possessions are still the same as it was last year or the year before that, they're not walking in the perfect plan for God. They missed out on something that God has in store for because they didn't work their mouth and mind. They waited for God to do something. God said, but you're not thinking or speaking on the levels of salvation that brings you in what the supply of the Spirit holds for you. And we have to understand, it's not going to be because, no, I've felt the presence of God, you know, in praise and worship. Oh, that was so awesome. Oh, Demetrius, Ronnie, and Pastor Sonny, oh, that song was so good. Yeah, but you still got to use your mind and your mouth. You still got to do that. And sometimes people can praise, and then after that they say, man, life is just tough. Well, okay, that's going to be your life. It's not going to be mine's. Hey, man, it's not going to be mine. When I get around people, they talk about, you know, conditions of their life. And I said, no, that is not going to happen on me. I said, listen, I believe that I live to 120 years old. I don't care what the doctor said. I choose what God said. Amen. Now, I respect the docs. I respect, you know, I believe the extension of God's love. I'm going to do my part. Amen. But I'm not going out here in aches and pains and I'm not going out here half broke. I'm not going to do that. When I say half broke, I'm talking about, you know, sickness and disease. We're not going to have that. Because we've been redeemed from that. And the Bible said, let the redeemer of the Lord say so. If you're not saying what you should say, then you're receiving what life throws to you. Amen. But you got to keep working with your mind and your mouth, because that is the system where salvation make things. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. All right. So let's travel over here to let's look at Philippians 3 and verse 12. And if you have a question based on what I'm talking about tonight, we're gonna leave some room for that if you have a question, you know, because sometimes we think people know certain things and they, you know, find out that they don't, or they need more clarity. I said verse 12, right? He said, not as though I have already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow. Let me make sure I got the right thing. But I follow after it, that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended. Okay, let's go to, I think I gave you the wrong, I know I gave you. Let's look at, I always do that. It's 2, chapter 2 and verse 12. Okay. Well, let's start right there. Look at it. He said, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Then verse 12. Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, when I'm not around you, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. He said, work it out. He said, when you're with me and when we're all in fellowship, we all know what to say. We know, you know, I can start a verse and you can finish it. I can start a sentence and you can conclude it. He said, but when I'm not with you, work out your own salvation. When he said with fear and trembling, he's talking about in such awe and expectations that it makes you make you shake, get excited about. He ain't talking about, like, you know, work it out, you know, or God gonna kill you. See, we're like, you about to do it with fear and trembling. You about to obey God and don't be happy. What kind of deal is that? Okay. Well, watch this now. I don't know which one was the worst. Is the Ku Klux Klan or the ladies in the white dress for the Pentecostal church? I don't know which one was worse. But anyhow, look at this then. Because they were scared the jelly beans out you. Where you been? You ain't been in church. Come on here, let me get you delivered. Come on, ha cha 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 cha. They spitting all on you. You need a windshield wipe on your face. I like they like. Are you okay? Let's go back to this. I'm sorry. I can do this. I can do it. Okay, we got it. Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, that is in my presence only, but now much more. Somebody say much more. That's when you need to really work it out, when you're by yourself, much more. Much more in my absence. Work out your own. So what? It belongs to me. Work out. See, some people want other people to do it. I think Holy Spirit, let's put it away. God is saying, I have equipped you to get deliverance in your life as one individual. And sometimes we think, okay, I need this person, I need this, I need that. He said, no, you got your own, work it out. Well, I need a man for bring more money, I need a woman to do that. He said, no, you got your own, work it out. And so salvation makes us whole and complete in any and every area of our life. So he said, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, but this is part we're doing. How do I work it out? You work it out the same way you worked it in. Amen. The same way you worked it in, salvation came in. How did it come in? You believe in your heart and confession unto righteousness was made. Your confession mouth was made unto salvation. Amen. You work it out the way that you work it in. So you work out your salvation, because the salvation is in you. You got to work it out. And so you got to make sure that the first thought is not negative, and we don't go into panic mode. And I'm going to tell you, as a leader, you want to do anything in life, there could be many situations to come that challenge you, to make you think, okay, maybe I need to do, you know, something different. Maybe, no, not say something different. Maybe I won't be successful based on how these things look. God said, work out your salvation. Because being a leader, want to do something great in life, you're going to have many challenges against what you want in life. You have many challenges against that. But you got to believe that God's word holds the final authority for everything that God has in store for you, and you actually can work it out. Amen. Like a lot of people say, work it out, but he's not, you know, they talking about God, he will work it out. God said, no. He said, I'm sitting down. You work it out. Isn't that something? Work it out, won't he work it? God said, listen. He said, guys, I want you to understand, read the Bible, stop making up songs that don't line up with scripture, you work it out. Stop singing lying songs. Well, it's a good song, but you don't understand. He already worked it out, but you got to work it out. I'm not taking anything from her, but some people think, okay, I just shout, dance, and praise to God. When I go outside, there's a big old clown out there with a nice pretty box that's going to give me, and those unicorns and stuff around the flying around will give you. No. You got to work it out. You got to let the devil know you ain't taking nothing from me, no experience from me that God has in store for me. I'm going to work this thing out. Amen. Amen. You got to work it out the same way that you worked it in. Believe in your heart. And confession made unto salvation. Mm-hmm. So every day that you go home, you rejoice. You know, every day that you have, you rejoice of the salvation that you've been equipped with, and you started using it. You don't use it when you, okay, I got a challenge. You got to use it. For favor, you use it for answered prayers. You use it for, you know, endeavors, protection. You got to open up your mouth. But you got to, the thing is, you got to keep your mind key to the salvation. You follow me? And key that I have a Savior. And see, you can't, if you have a Savior, I have salvation, I know everything's gonna happen the way it's supposed to happen, because I got Jesus there making sure that it bounced right. Amen. And so it's important that we keep our minds on this. And I was dealing with something today, and God said, you thinking about something that you didn't teach, son. He said, no, get out of that. He said, think on this. He said, now open your mouth and say something. It doesn't matter how it looks. He said it still works the same. Because when you got saved, life was pitiful, and it worked. So everything don't have to be hunky-dory in order for it to work. You know, you can have the greatest trials in your life, and it still will work. Amen. Because nothing can stop your salvation. Nothing can defeat you. Not a thing. Mm-mm. It's amazing. A person can go to jail for a crime. The worst thing, they can be sentenced to something. Watch this now, but they still can receive salvation. Isn't that amazing? And so the situation didn't stop what God promised. Now, they may have to still deal with some, you know, recompenses and things to that degree, but it didn't stop their eternal side. It didn't stop them from prospering. And now they got Wi-Fi jails. They got computers. People are coming out like what Bill Winston ministry does. They got tailored suits for them. They got jobs already ready before they get out. Amen. So don't tell me salvation don't work while you're in, you know, it can't. You can be in captivity, but you can't be held captive. Amen. Hey, you follow what I'm saying? Because you're coming out of that if you know that you're saved. God will make somebody, call somebody to put a plan, something in there where people are praying. Amen. Reduce the sentence. Bring some type of creativity, an idea there where people are praying and believing God. And most of these things happen where the inmates are actually watching and listening and conducting Bible studies based on profound teachings. And these things happen. Because they don't happen in every jails. Amen. But they are happening in jails. To the point now it's truly correctional centers. Not a place of punishment, but a correctional center. Correctional center means correcting my life, an opportunity to focus on the things that make my life better. Amen. Not just to throw me in, I come out and I go back again. Hey, I'm back. Why? Because I didn't get no correction the last time I was here. And so that's so powerful that these prisons are turning to boarding schools. Amen. And then there's some high schools, even one in our city, they have daycare in the high schools for the young pregnant mothers. Or for the young mother. I said, that is awesome. That is so beautiful. Why? Because when people come together and pray and put a demand on what God has promised them, God will change the laws and everything, make things happen for you. Amen. So I'm just going to stop right there because, you know, I have a lot I want to share. But one of the things I really want to say is don't neglect your salvation. Give attention to it. You know, I'm going to say practice it, but learn how to use it. Okay? Learn how to use it and allow it to assist you in life. You know, we was doing these new courses overseas, and I was telling them, I said, you know, one church where we put an Urban Hobby Faith University in, we're doing it for 2 years. And I was talking to another location, and I said, I gave you a portion of the materials because my name is not on your certificates. So it's not the one who certify and get a certificate is supposed to be the one who conducts, examines, and grades. Okay, so I can't do everything and then you get a certificate. I said, not gonna be that way. I said, we're doing for 2 years. That was one church, they went for two. I said, that's good. Because you got a lot of preachers and believers, they just don't know. You know, they don't know enough of the right things. And this is important. That's a preacher knowing the right words and know how to teach is just like a surgeon know how to use a scalpel, know how to use, you know, the instruments in the surgery room. It's just as important because every person who stands or sit before them, you're doing surgery on their hearts and their minds. It's a level of trust and belief that they are confiding in because you're speaking to them. And so if a student goes to medical school for 4 to 8 years, I believe we could do it quicker than the little time that we'd be doing just to get a piece of paper. Amen. So we make sure that these students, they'll be soon to be pastors and leaders that, okay, I will give you the exam. And I'm going to give you the video, the material, and then I'm going to examine you and I'm going to grade you. You know, from there, I'm going to help you and cause you to learn, not so you that you just go over a period of time and say, okay, I did my time. Boom. We ain't going to do that. No, we ain't putting no clowns out there. We're not going to do that. We'll make sure we are equipped and we are strong. It's a big task, but I thank God for the opportunity to put that Urban Harvey Faith University in different churches around the world. Amen. I'm happy about it. It's going to take work, but I'm happy about it because we help shape a culture, a nation, and generations when we do that. And like I said, it's a lot of work, but God will grace me salvation and make the things available for me because you can watch on television and you see the stuff that people are preaching now. It's amazing what people are preaching. You know, there's no foundation. You can't do nothing without foundation and salvation and righteousness because salvation ushers you to righteousness. And the Bible says this in closing. He said, it's talking about the foundation of righteousness. If the foundations are removed, then what can the righteous do? The righteous can't do anything because the foundation is salvation and righteousness. What can you do? What can you put your faith on? You know? Because when I understand that this is my foundation, I can build hope, grace. I can go to levels and levels because I have the foundation. See, there are things people trying to do, they can't do it because they don't have the foundation right. And anything that you teach out of this Bible, any new person, it has to start with salvation and righteousness. You can't teach anything out of that. You can't teach faith yet because they ain't going to understand. They don't know where I'm going to put it at. You know, you're going to put faith on righteousness and salvation. Amen. Let's pray. Fathers, in Jesus' name we come, Lord. We want to say thank you for your word tonight. Thank you for the clarity. We thank you for the information. And Father, I acknowledge you in the midst of this great congregation, Lord God, that this is your ability. And Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that you get the honor for it. And if there's anyone around this world that's listening and viewing with us today, the Bible said, the day you hear his voice, it do not harden your heart. So if you never confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or you want to return back to him, this is the greatest day for it. Amen. So I want to pray this prayer with you in Jesus' name. Say, Father, in Jesus' name I come, and I confess that Jesus is Lord. He is the Christ. He is the Son of God. And I believe and I confess that you sent him to die for my sins, all of my sins, and that by your power, your love, you raised him from the dead for me, that I be justified, that I be saved, and I be righteous, and I can grow in faith in all the wonderful things that you have in store for me. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer, you're sincere with it. I want to say congratulations, welcome to and welcome back to the kingdom of God. God has great things in store for you. And also, you can email us at myincreasetoday@gmail.com. And you can get the next 10 steps what to do after you get saved. And that's important to know what to do. If there's anything else we can help with your spiritual endeavors, do not hesitate to contact us. We'll be more than happy to serve you where those spiritual growth is concerned. And Father, I pray for every viewer. I pray, I rebuke confusion, lack, and sickness, and doubt, and fear, and frustrations out of their life. I plead the blood of Jesus to their wholeness of their house. I decree and I declare that their house is saved, and their house is healed, and their house is restored. And Lord, we lift up the Seville family. We pray for them. We pray for Terry Seville, his wife, and and his staff and partners all around the world. We thank you for that great soldier. And Lord, we thank you that his reward is awesome. And Lord God, I pray a special grace upon them. Lord God, that they're only affected by the joyful things that you have in store for them. We thank you, Lord God, they will plunder into great prosperity and take over more airwaves and more nations because of the work that you have done through him, through Dr. Jerry Savelle. We want to say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. So if you want to give tonight, these are the ways to give. If you want to give electronically, you can go to your app store and type in Givelify, and then type in Increase International Ministries and look for the church logo. Or you can go to a Cash App and type in $increase today, the number 5. Or you can mail into Increase International Ministries, P.O. Box 2295, Chesterfield, Virginia, 23832. Or you can go to Tithely, that's ty.ly, and then type in again, Increase International Ministries. And you can give that way, they'll hold all records of your contributions. And so we want you to set your expectations for your financial harvest. We want to say thank you for viewing and thank you for any contributions that you have made today. May heaven smile upon you. And we invite you to meet us again here this Sunday, 10 o'clock, live streaming on Prayer Warfare. We're praying for together and for our ministries, and you can unite with us. That's 10 o'clock live stream every Sunday, and then that's from 10 to 10:30, and then we'll go into our live stream service starting at 11 o'clock. God bless you. Thank you so very much for taking the time to fellowship with us. Just conclude our service for tonight. Hope to see you.